Scripture, which comes from the book of Matthew, as Matthew 5, verse 10, I do believe, yes. You ready? You want me to hold this for you? You can go right up there if you want, because you're in charge right now.
Happy are those who are persecuted because they do what God requires. The kingdom of heaven belongs to them. Matthew 5:10.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you very much.
Very good.
You already knew what to do, didn't you?
Today we're going to continue taking a look at the gospel in the book of Genesis. And today we're going to go to Genesis chapter 4. We're going to, again, take a look at the gospel, as well as seeing how the book of Genesis correlates with end-time Bible prophecy, which we've taken a look at so far. We've seen the investigative judgment in the book of Genesis. We've seen the state of the dead in the book of Genesis. We've seen the promise of a Messiah in the book of Genesis. And so now we're going to continue, and hopefully today find some more interesting things. Genesis chapter 4, beginning with verse 1, says, Adam knew his wife Eve, and she became pregnant. When she gave birth to Cain, she said, with the Lord's help, I have produced a man. Verse 2, then she gave birth to his brother and named him Abel. When they grew up, Abel became a shepherd, while Cain cultivated the ground. When it was time for harvest, Cain presented some of his crops as a gift to the Lord. Verse 4, Abel also brought a gift, the best portions of the firstborn lambs from his flock. The Lord accepted Abel and his gift, but he did not accept Cain and his gift. This made Cain very angry, and he looked dejected. So again, right here, we're finding salvation in the book of Genesis. We're finding that Abel brought a lamb, which also wasn't just a lamb, it was the best portion that he had. So Abel is bringing his best. And that's very important. You know, when God gave his son, he wasn't just giving some animal or even an angel or whatever he had left over that he could give. He gave his very best when he gave us his son. And so God would like in exchange our very best. I remember reading an article a while back about a lady that was working with the community service center in her church. And many of us, like myself, when we find something in our closet that we don't want to wear anymore, we're like, okay, this can go to Goodwill, this can go to the community service center. I'm such a good person, I'm giving to other people what I don't even want. And so we give it to the community service center, Goodwill, whatever. We don't need it anymore, don't want it anymore. If we didn't give it to them, we were just going to throw it away. Well, this article I read was about a lady who was working for the community service center in her church, and she understood that those people coming in represented Jesus. And she thought to herself, I don't want to just give Jesus what I have left over. I don't want to give Jesus just what I wouldn't wear myself. So she went, bought clothes she would buy for herself, brand new, and gave them to the people that came into the community service center. And then she wore what was there at the community service center, because she wanted to give Jesus her very best. Because he gave his very best for her. And so here we find Abel giving the best of what he has. And so let's take a look in Malachi chapter 1, verse 7 and 8, because Malachi, the Lord in Malachi, has something to say about this. Malachi is the last book of the Old Testament. Malachi chapter 1, verses 7 and 8. Or we'll start with 7 and 8. And I'm reading from the NLT. It says, "You have shown contempt by offering defiled sacrifices on my altar. Then you ask, how have we defiled the sacrifices? You defile them by saying the altar of the Lord deserves no respect. When you give blind animals as a sacrifice, isn't that wrong? And isn't it wrong to offer animals that are crippled and diseased? Try giving gifts like that to your governor and see how pleased he is," says the Lord of Heaven's armies. Verse 9, "Go ahead, beg God to be merciful to you. But when you bring that kind of offering, why should he show you any favor at all?" asked the Lord of Heaven's armies. "How I wish one of you would shut the temple doors so that these worthless sacrifices could not be offered. I am not pleased," says the Lord of Heaven's armies. "I will not accept your offerings." Okay, so here God is telling his people the same thing he was telling Cain. I'm not going to accept your offerings because I know what you're giving me isn't the best that you have. What you're giving me is just what you have left over. What you're giving me is what you weren't going to use anyway. And then you're bringing it as if it's some kind of a gift. Jesus gave his very best for us. The Father gave us his Son. He gave us everything. He gave us the very best. And when we appreciate that, we're going to be like the woman that brought that perfume that cost a year's wages, that cost everything that she had, and offer that as a gift because she realized Jesus was giving everything that he had. And when we appreciate the gospel, that faith, you know, there in Luke 7, verse 50, Jesus tells that woman, your faith has saved you. And that faith was that appreciation for the sacrifice that Jesus made for her, and she expressed her faith by giving back the best that she had. And that is what Abel was doing. He was looking for that lamb that he brought, the best lamb available. He knew, pointed towards Jesus dying on the cross for our sins. He was giving the best he had because God was giving the best that he had as well. And of course, we say, well, Cain was a farmer. He was bringing his fruits, his vegetables. You know, the fact is, in the Old Testament, grain offerings were accepted if it was the best that you had. So God would have accepted Cain's sacrifice if that had really been the best that Cain had. But God knew good and well Cain could have secured a lamb from Abel if he had wanted to. But instead, Cain brought his works. These are the fruits that I planted, that I harvested. Lord, here are my works. And that's another way that we look at this story, is we see that Cain brought his works, presented his works as a form of salvation, while Abel was looking at the lamb who would be slain on the cross for our salvation. And so here again, we see legalism trying to be saved by our works. And we see this throughout the book of Genesis. We saw this when Adam tried to clothe himself by making fig leaves. We see it now with Cain trying to present his works, his produce, his crops. Again, trying to be saved by his works. We'll see it later at the Tower of Babel when they're trying to build their own way to heaven to save themselves. Over and over, we see again and again man trying to save himself by his own works. And over again, we see the only way to be saved is by the Lamb that was slain from the foundation of the world. So, Cain's gift was rejected. In verse 6 of Genesis 4, why are you so angry? The Lord asked Cain. Why do you look so dejected? You will be accepted if you do what is right. But if you refuse to do what is right, then watch out. Sin is crouching at the door, eager to control you. But you must subdue it and be its master. Verse 8. One day Cain suggested to his brother, let's go out into the fields. And while they were in the field, Cain attacked his brother Abel and killed him. Verse 9. Afterward, the Lord asked Cain, where is your brother? Where is Abel? I don't know, Cain responded. Am I my brother's guardian? Verse 10, but the Lord said, what have you done? Listen, your brother's blood cries out to me from the ground. Okay, now, what God is obviously saying here is what you have done to Abel calls for vengeance, right? When he says your brother's blood cries from the ground, he wasn't meaning I can literally, audibly hear your brother's blood crying out to me. It was symbolic, right? Absolutely. Well, let's take a look at Revelation, go to the other end of the Bible. In Revelation chapter 6, beginning with verse 9, we have the fifth seal in the book of Revelation. And it says here in verse 9, when the Lamb broke the fifth seal, I saw under the altar the souls of all who had been martyred for the word of God and for being faithful in their testimony. Verse 10, they shouted to the Lord and said, O sovereign Lord, holy and true, how long before you judge the people who belong to this world and avenge our blood for what they have done to us? Okay, is this literally happening under the altar up in heaven? No, it's symbolic, right? Just like Abel's blood was symbolically crying out for justice, so this is a symbolic picture of the fifth seal. There are no souls. I had somebody here a couple of years ago visiting with me, and they thought they were going to give me a lesson on the state of the dead. Not that I don't have a lot to learn. I don't mean that arrogantly. But they use this verse to tell me that when we die, we go straight to heaven. And I had to ask them, okay, I have several questions for you. So you're telling me when we go to heaven, we're all going to be hiding under an altar. And then when we're all in heaven, we're going to be crying out to Jesus, get even with the people who put us up here with you. Seriously, I don't think so. I don't think we're going to be in heaven saying, you pay back those people that put us here with you. No, that's not going to happen. This is a symbolic case. Okay, when we go to heaven, we're not going to be literally hiding under an altar. And we are not going to be asking for vengeance. Or vengeance be done to the people who put us up in heaven. Okay? The verse goes on and it becomes quite clear. In verse 11, it says, then a white robe was given to each of them, and they were told to rest a little longer. They're dead. They're sleeping. They don't know anything. When Abel was dead, the blood was symbolically crying out for vengeance. Abel was not crying out for vengeance. And here what God is saying in the fifth seal is, I see what has happened to my martyrs, and I will avenge them, but they will rest, sleep in their graves a little longer. All right? So, we go back to, first let's go to Hebrews 11:4. Because in Hebrews 11:4, it makes this clear as well. It says, it was by faith that Abel brought a more acceptable offering to God than Cain did. And again, Abel was bringing his very best, but Abel was also bringing a lamb that represented the only solution for our sin problem, and that was the Lamb of God dying on the cross for us. Cain was bringing his works, his own system of a man-made way of salvation. But it says here in verse 4 of Hebrews 11, it was by faith that Abel brought a more acceptable offering to God than Cain did. Abel's offering gave evidence that he was a righteous man, and God showed his approval of his gifts. Now it says, although Abel is long dead, Okay, nowhere in the Bible does it ever talk about anybody dying and going straight to heaven. It says, now that Abel is long dead, it doesn't say now that Abel is up in heaven. It says, since Abel is long dead, he still speaks to us by his example of faith. So Abel is not still literally speaking to us. His example is still speaking to us. Right? Abel, the Bible says, is long dead. Again, resting until Jesus comes. But it's also telling us that his gift was accepted because his gift wasn't presenting his own works as Cain did. His gift was pointing towards Jesus dying on the cross. Let's go back to Genesis chapter 4. Verse 10 again, the Lord says, what have you done? Listen, your brother's blood cries out to me from the ground. Now you are cursed and banished from the ground, which has swallowed your brother's blood. No longer will the ground yield good crops for you, no matter how hard you work. Cain needed to learn the lesson we all need to learn, and that is no matter how hard we work, our works will never save us. The only thing that will save us is, again, Jesus dying for us on the cross. Several years ago, I studied with a man in another church and baptized him. And then a couple of years later, he was telling me that he was in a certain district, Ybor City, there in Tampa, handing out literature. And he said, I was handing out religious literature, and somebody came up to me and said, why are you handing out this literature? What do you get for it? And he said, I told him, I get eternal life. And I told him, I said, you don't get eternal life for handing out literature. You get eternal life from the cross of Jesus Christ. That's where you get eternal life. And so we all need to be reminded that we don't work our way to heaven, and as Cain needed to be reminded, we're not saved by our own system of worship. Because there is another parallel, and the other parallel is found in Revelation 14, 9 through 12. We go back to Revelation. Again, you can go back and forth from Genesis to Revelation so many times because history repeats itself. And many of the events in Genesis take place again in Revelation. And so in Revelation chapter 14, starting with verse 9, we have the third angel's message. And it says, then a third angel followed them, shouting, anyone who worships the beast and his image, or who accepts his mark on the forehead or on the hand, must drink the wine of God's anger. It has been poured out full strength into God's cup of wrath, and they will be tormented with fire and burning sulfur in the presence of the holy angels of the Lamb. Okay, what is this mark? Well, as we study Bible prophecy as Seventh-day Adventists, we understand the mark of the beast is when Sunday observance is enforced. And it tells us that in Revelation 13, those who have the mark will not be able to buy and sell. They won't be able to do business. They won't be able to put bread on their family's table unless they take that mark. Now, those who go ahead and take the mark represent Cain, who thought he would be saved by presenting his own works. Okay, when we present Sunday in the place of Sabbath, we're presenting a work day. and our works will never save us. Jesus rose on the first day of the week. He told Mary, don't worship me yet. I need to go see my father. I need to get back to work. This is Sunday. It's a work day for me. I just rested on the Sabbath. Now I need to get to work. Okay? Sunday represents works. And so those that are substituting Sunday in the place of Saturday are substituting works in the place of grace. And let's see how that works. It says that those who accept that in verse 10 must drink the wine of God's anger. It has been poured out full strength into God's cup of wrath. Do you remember Jesus in Gethsemane? Who was saying, if you can, Father, let this cup pass from me. That cup was the wine of God's wrath. Jesus drank that cup for you and me. And we rest on Sabbath as a sign that we are saved by the blood of Jesus alone. We are not saved by our works. When we rest on the Sabbath, we're saying, I'm not trusting my works to put bread on my family's table. I'm not trusting my ability to do business. I'm not trusting my ability to buy and sell to put bread on my family's table. I trust Jesus to put bread on my family's table. Those who accept Sunday at that time are saying, I don't trust Jesus to save me. I'll take that mark. I'll buy and sell. I'll do business. I'll work. I'll put bread on my family's table. I don't trust Jesus to do it for me. And when they do that, they are not rejecting just the Sabbath. They are rejecting the cross. They are rejecting Jesus drinking that cup for them. And what they say is, never mind, Jesus. Give us that cup. We'll drink it ourselves. That's why they drink the wine of God's wrath. Because they have rejected the cross. They've rejected Jesus drinking that cup for them. And they've said, we will save ourselves. We'll come up with our own system of worship. We'll come up with our own Sabbath. We'll come up with our own plan of salvation, and we will save ourselves. And then after they drink that, it says they will be tormented with fire and burning sulfur in the presence of the holy angels of the Lamb. The smoke of their torment will rise forever and ever, and they will have no rest day or night. No relief or no rest. They have no rest because they just rejected the Sabbath that gives them rest. They've just rejected righteousness by faith and decided they'll work out their own system of worship and they'll be saved by working instead of by resting. Friends, that's why the Sabbath was so important to the children of Israel when they came out of Egypt. God was telling them, back in Egypt, you did all the work so Pharaoh could rest. Now I'm going to give you my Sabbath as a sign that I'm going to do all the work now so that you can rest. But when we reject God's rest, we reject His plan of salvation. We reject His sacrifice. And we set about to come up with our own system of salvation. And our own way of worship instead of like Abel worshiping the way that God had planned. Verse 12 of Revelation 14 says, this means that God's holy people must endure persecution patiently, obeying His commands, and maintaining their faith in Jesus. And right here we see those who have the faith of Jesus keep the commandments. We can't say we have the faith of Jesus if we are not keeping His commandments. Those who have faith keep the commandments. And it also tells us we have to endure persecution patiently. Because friends, Paul tells us, all those who live godly lives will suffer persecution. Why? Because when we live godly lives, we make the rest of the world look bad. And the world doesn't like to look bad. Years ago when I was in Texas, there was a family in my church. Their daughter was being homeschooled at the time. She had been to public school. She was vegan. And they were telling me when she was vegan in public school, the kids thought, oh, well, that's interesting. You know, that's kind of cool. That's different. That's neat. Then they put her in the Adventist church school, and she was vegan. And in the Adventist church school, all the church kids made fun of her for being vegan, to the point to where they just took her out and homeschooled her. Why were the kids in church school giving her such a hard time when the people in public school weren't? Because the church school kids took it as a rebuke. Because the church school kids knew there was a health standard and they did not want to meet up to it. So what did they do? They did the same thing that Judas did to the woman that was washing Jesus' feet. What did Judas say? Oh, well, this is a waste of money. This is a waste of resources. This is just going overboard. This is fanatical what she's doing. She wasn't fanatical. She was just giving everything to Jesus because Jesus was giving everything for her. But Judas is there watching it, and Judas is thinking, I'm not going to give that much. I'm not going to give what I have. I'm here to get rich, not to give money away. And so what does Judas do to make himself look better? He has to point at somebody who is giving their best and say, that's fanatical. That is what those kids were doing to that girl in church school. To make themselves look good where they were, they had to make her look fanatical. And that is what happens in the world today. We see somebody giving more than we want to give. Somebody who is following Jesus all the way because Jesus died for them, and we're thinking, well, I'm not going to walk that close to God. So to make myself look good, I have to make them look fanatical. And that's where the persecution comes. Until we are walking close with God, the world has no reason to persecute us. The world has no reason to persecute us as long as we're just reflecting the world. But it's when we raise the standard that the persecution comes. Let's take a look at 1 John 3, 11 through 13. This is the message that you have heard from the beginning. We should love one another. And you know what breaks my heart isn't when people hate me in the world because I walk with Jesus. What breaks my heart is when people in the church hate me because I walk with Jesus. Just like those kids in that church school, persecuting that girl because she was walking with Jesus the best she could. That's what really hurts. Verse 12, we must not be like Cain, who belonged to the evil one and killed his brother. And why did he kill him? Now, those of you that know me know I love a good mystery. And so we're going to solve this mystery now. We have a motive. Why did he kill him? Because Cain had been doing what was evil, and his brother had been doing what was righteous. So don't be surprised, dear brothers and sisters, if the world hates you. And I like to add as well, don't be surprised if the church hates you too. So, it was because Abel was holding the standard where it belonged that the persecution came. That happened in Genesis 4. It happens in Revelation 14. Jesus talks about it in Matthew chapter 5. Matthew chapter 5, verse 10. As Ricky was reading earlier, God blesses those who are persecuted for doing right, for the kingdom of heaven is theirs. We'll go on here with verses 11 and 12 as well. God blesses you when people mock you and persecute you and lie about you and say all sorts of evil things against you because you are my followers. Be happy about it. Be very glad, for a great reward awaits you in heaven. And remember, the ancient prophets and Abel were persecuted in the same way. My friends, when we're persecuted for doing what's right, we can rejoice. Now, I need to clarify, we need to be careful that we're rejoicing when we're persecuted for doing what's right. I have a friend who had a painting business years ago in Oklahoma, and he hired a man to work for him who had just become a Christian, or was calling himself a Christian. And he was getting calls at work because he wasn't paying his electric bill, and wasn't paying his water bill, and wasn't paying any of his bills. And after all these bill collectors were hounding him on the phone at work, he turns to my friend and says, "See how I've been persecuted since becoming a Christian?" He wasn't persecuted for being a Christian. He was persecuted because he wasn't paying his bills. There's a difference. We need to make sure, you know, and that's the thing I have to do. If I'm being persecuted, first thing I have to do is look at myself and wait a minute. Do I deserve this? Is there something I need to make right? Okay? Because fact is, sometimes I do wrong things and I get persecuted not because I'm a Christian. I get persecuted because I'm wrong and I deserved it. But then there's also times that we are walking with God and we are doing what's right. And when Jesus says, when we are persecuted for doing what's right, to rejoice because great is our reward in heaven. So I want to encourage all of us to be like Abel. First, let's give our very best because Jesus gave his very best for us. And let's not come up with our own man-made system of worship or system of salvation. Let's remember the Lamb that points us to Jesus, that is our only hope of salvation. God bless you. Do we have any questions over our study today? No questions? Okay. Our closing hymn is hymn number 322.